Life Lessons with Juvy. What the fuck is up, folks? I am your host, as always, unless it's your first episode, then welcome. JuvyThaKid. Hit me up on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Periscope. At JuvyThaKid. JuvyThaKid. Let's get to the topics. I don't know why I'm so aggressive right now. Little Jenny Wren. Mythology and folklore. Does it have a place in the modern world? Has science, religions killed off the magic and superstition? Does modern folklore exist? Oh, this is such a good topic. Holy shit. Okay, so this is for me, especially right now, like, this is an amazing topic to be able to talk about. So thank you to Little Jenny Wren for submitting this. I've been reading the book, The Real Middle Earth, and holy shit, it's such a good book, and honestly, it's even certain things that, like, I've learned throughout, like, history class and things we see in the movies and everything, like, reading this book has, like, flipped it on its head and, like, shown me that I was completely wrong, and I love it. But at the same time, it shows, like, how we've really gotten away from, the magic of, like, folklore and the magic of, like, these tales of, like, amazing, like, beasts or magical beings, whatever it could be. Yeah, I don't know. Dude, let's get into this. Let's get into it. Does it have a place in the modern world? Yeah, I think it does. Honestly, now more than ever, probably. The thing is, a lot of the time when we think of the modern world, we think of, like, where we're living. Because, we're still in a modern world. It's just some people are living very, very differently from us. And some people still do, actually, like, there's a lot of cultures and everything that still do have a very heavy folklore and kind of, I don't want to say mythology, because, like, when you think about it, all religion is mythology. The tale of a god or a godly-like being coming to Earth, interacting with us somehow. There's a resurrection, that is Greek mythology, Christianity, like, most religions follow that kind of, like, archetype story almost. Really good point. I'm gonna hold this thought, and we're gonna jump back to it just in a little bit. So, for me, yes, it does have a place in the modern world, because it's one of those things, like, if we don't hear these stories of these, like, magical beings or these, like, these different animals and creatures, like, that dwell in the forest, one, we don't have the fear in us. Two, we won't have the curiosity in us. Three, we'll just only live in this, like, little bubble, and we'll never have, like, these thoughts that kind of, like, lead us through these imagination-filled worlds, you know what I mean? Okay. Has science / religion killed off the magic and superstition? This is where we're going to jump back to that thought. So, what I was saying is how, like, a lot of religions are pretty much, they're, like, mythology and religion is basically the same thing. I think it would be really cool if I went to Greece or something, like, nowadays. Like, just example, tomorrow I fly out, I go to Greece. And I actually, if there were still people who believed in Poseidon, believed in Zeus, and everything like that, that would be so fucking cool. Because that's, like, that is, like, the old world still present in our time. You know what I mean? When it comes to, like, science can explain some things. But there's some things within science that humans have tried to figure out. When I say we, when it comes to, like, science and stuff, I'm talking about humans. I don't mean me. Because though, like, the scientists that work on atoms and all that, like, no. Wait, they're in a different planet than me when it comes to intelligence on stuff like that. But what I'm saying is, as humans, when we do the, like, scientific tests on certain things, there are certain things that we can't measure them, we don't know how they exist, and we can't figure it out, even through science. With religion, the real Middle Earth, it talks about how this happened when the Romans came in and were pushing, pushing against the Celts and everything. Early AD 41, they landed, and then they stayed for, like, four centuries. But it was the same thing. Like, as they came in, they were pushing the Celts, like, folklore, like, beliefs out. And then when Christianity came about in, like, AD 500, then everything else, like, that's when a lot of things started changing. It was more, it wasn't even really, because the way we always classify, we classify, like, okay, mythology, that's Poseidon and Zeus and Odin and, like, whatever, you know what I mean? Like, just, I know Odin and Zeus are different, but you guys know what I'm talking about. So when we take a look at that, it's like, we look at that and we're like, oh, that's mythology, those are stories. But then we talk about God or Jesus, and that's a religion, because people believe that actually happened, but these gods didn't actually happen. That doesn't make sense to me. That never has, and it never will. It's the same thing. Like, you're saying that this God exists and everything, but these never existed. Those are just stories. Like, that's what we do when we say, like, mythology, religion. My thoughts, anyway. So when Christianity came about in 500, that's when a lot of the old, like, beliefs and the old practices and rituals started really getting pushed out. And this isn't like an attack on Christianity or anyone who believes in God or Jesus or anything like that. This is how it went in history. So if we do the whole mythology versus religion, just for sake of conversation, in a way, yes, religion did try and kind of kill mythology. I don't believe it succeeded, because there's still people like me that are still obsessed with those old tales, or still obsessed with Norse gods and Greek gods and the Romans. And there's still so much out there for me to learn. And I believe with, like, people like that, I'm not saying it's only me, obviously, but with when we have people like that still in this world, that shows that the love of it, the passion of it, and the want for it is still very present in our time, even with the science and religion. Because, like I said, science can't, there's even things within science that they can't figure out and they can't, like, measure and everything. With religion, it kind of falls in the same, like, category as mythology, but for some reason, because of the movement of Christianity and the attitude that has been built up over generations and generations, like, we differentiate the two. And even in, like I said, in 500 AD, they tried to differentiate the two, physically, everything. So I think they tried, but it didn't work, because with the magic of, like, the mythology, we're going to go with Poseidon, just because it's the ocean. I've always loved the ocean, so we'll go with that. So Poseidon, it's one of those things where there's certain things happen in the ocean and we can be like, oh, it's the wind, it's that, it's this. But, like, there's that magic about it that, for me, like, just maybe certain things, like, I don't know, maybe it just won't add up for me in the same way it does for somebody else. But it's one of, like, when I see a huge tidal waves hitting each other in these, maybe not tidal waves, but giant waves crashing against each other, and with the way, like, certain animals in the ocean will just be, like, swimming separately and then just come together in group, and they just guide through the water. Like, I don't know, there's certain things that make me feel like there is, like, almost like a godly magic at hand. I know certain people will jump up right away and be like, well, that's God. Well, it could also be Poseidon, so calm the fuck down. For superstition, I don't think it killed the superstition, it just tried to replace it. Because with Christianity came the fear of sin, came the fear of God punishing you for not being a good person. It's one of those things, too, that, like, you can't just live on this narrow path, you know what I mean? The narrow path will keep you in, like, the line, and you'll probably get to, like, a certain goal, but that's because this narrow path is only showing you this one goal, and you think that's all there is to it, kind of thing. You got to live on the wider path, because then it's, you can see everything, you could take everything in and, like, have different sources of information coming at you. But we're not talking about that, we're talking about superstition, so my bad. So with the superstition, all it did was try to replace it. Was instead of, don't anger the gods or Poseidon will send a flood our way. Don't anger Zeus or we'll have lightning bolts thrown at us. It was, don't anger God or we're going to have locusts come at us. Don't anger God or you fucking have to spend an eternity in hell or you're punishable by sins, whatever it is. Like, they did was take the one superstition and try to replace it. Much like they tried to replace with all the beliefs in place there. So no, I don't think it killed off anything. I think it tried to, but it hasn't. Only my opinion though. Does modern folklore exist? I was thinking about this, and I know there's some people that right away might even be like, no, it doesn't, for sure it doesn't. But think about this. Think about the old tales, like the old folklore. It was these creatures that dwelled in the forest and these unknown things in the ocean. We still have that. Now, I know this might sound funny, but bear with me. Sasquatch and like the Bigfoot type animal dwelling around forests, the Yeti in the Himalayan mountains. That's all folklore. That's all modern folklore, really. Like, the Sasquatch stuff didn't start until, like, the 50s or 60s, or whatever. I'm not 100% clear on all that. And however you feel about it, it really doesn't matter, because I'm sure back then there were people who didn't believe the folklore tales, but they were out there. They existed. There were people who believed in it. So modern folklore does still exist. Even Cthulhu. I've talked to people that believe there could be a creature like Cthulhu or a godlike being instead of like Poseidon. You put Cthulhu there instead. But I've talked to people that believe in that as well. So modern folklore, it does still exist for sure. And it's only because like it's the people that we deem to be the weirdos that like we talk about it. So it seems... non-believable, or it seems like cliche. It's like, oh, well, of course you're going to talk about the government conspiracies, you're a stoner. It's like, well, no, it's not true at all. Like, you know what I mean? It's one of those things, like, if you look a certain way, or you live your life a certain way, whatever, when you try and talk about stuff like this, like modern folklore, people will just sweep it under the rug because of the attitude it is nowadays. Think of the Loch Ness Monster. Bigfoot, Yeti, aliens, whatever you want to say. Like, there's certain things, if you say that you believe in them, you're going to get laughed at or whatever it is. So, modern folklore does still exist. I'm 13 minutes just on this topic. That was a great one. Let's get to the next one. Dean, motherfucking wild. What's going on? What generation of music would you like to see come back? Ooh, good one. Who are some of your favorite artists / groups from that era? Right away, I gotta go with... Ooh, maybe not. Damn. I was gonna go with the 80s right away because there was such a diverse taste of music. But at the same time, the 90s had some good tunes as well. You know what? I would love to go with the like hip-hop purist of me and be like, oh, 90s hip-hop, bring back like all that. But you know what? No, I can't. In my heart of hearts, I gotta go with the 80s. We had Shout at the Devil with Motley Crue. We had Metallica. We had we had things like Flock of Seagulls. Like, Twisted Sister. And I keep saying we as humans, again, because I was born in 1990. But I grew up with parents that, like, the 80s were their, like, that was their, like, formative years and everything. So the 80s were still very prevalent in my home, like, growing up in the 90s as well. So for me, like, it's one of those things, like, there's so many, like, one-hit wonders that I fucking love from the 80s. Some of my favorite artists, Motley Crue, to this day, I still love Motley Crue. Rockwell, somebody's watching me. Wilson Phillips, gotta go with that. Who else? I fuck with Styx. I fuck with a little bit of Styx, not, like, a lot, though. Larry Gowan. He was alright, like, when he... I believe Larry Gowan came in as a replacement. If he didn't, I'm mistaken, then my bad. But either way, I liked Larry Gowan's solo stuff. So, boom. Who else? Oh, shit. Air Supply. I'll take me some Air Supply any day. I soft rock the fuck out to that. Yeah, we'll go with the 80s. All the artists that I listed, mucho bueno. Go listen to them all. Deli Boy, 86. MMA. Flexemoji. Where do I even start with this? Okay. Mixed martial arts. First of all, that's what MMA stands for. Mixed martial arts. If you're not familiar with that term, UFC. The mix of boxing, jiu-jitsu, Greco-Roman wrestling, I guess Brazilian jiu-jitsu, Muay Thai, kickboxing, like, whatever you're proficient in, really. Like, nowadays, there's guys who are proficient in everything. There's people out there that think it's like a meathead sport and there's no talent involved and whatever, but that's 100% not true. It's always one of those things, like, think of the toughest guy you knew in high school, put him against one of the even top five UFC guys, he's gonna get fucking beat up 10 times out of 10. I don't care how tough you thought he was, if he punched a kid out in one punch, against the top five MMA guys, like, let's not even go UFC, even in, like, Bellator 1FC, probably gonna get smoked. Like, I don't know. Like, there's too many tough guy, like, egos nowadays, and, like, there's certain things, like, if guys won't be, like, just swinging for the fences, no technique at all, like, people are like, oh, this is boring, I could beat him up, blah, blah, blah. Alright, cool. Well, then you look at guys like Anderson Silva in his prime, or Conor McGregor, when he, like, fighting Eddie Alvarez and Jose Aldo, starching him in one fucking punch. It's one of these things, like, you don't, like, you're on a different planet than these people, okay? Like, you can move forward with your, like, tough guy ego and just throwing crazy. They're going to move out of the way. You're going to be tired after a minute and a half, and then they're going to pick you apart for however long they feel like doing it. Like, it's one of these things, like, there's people try and say, like, mixed martial arts, there's no skill involved, but there's literally, like, a physical chess match at hand right now. Say you have a really amazing striker, no ground skills. You have a guy with okay striking, real great on the ground. Like, you get on the ground with this guy, your night's going to be short, probably. Let's go with that. And actually, you know, we can go with guys or girls, because there's obviously guys, in, like, male and female fighters. I can't help but make the argument, though, that as much as the female divisions are evolving and we're seeing killers come out, Joanna Jacek, multiple-time Muay Thai champion. We saw Jessica Andrade, who's really, like, I think is, like, a little, like, Vanderlei Silva, almost. Amanda Nunes, like, Holly Holm. We see a lot of, like, amazing, amazing female fighters, but because they're, like, that sport, as it is the same sport, but as, like, a women's mixed martial arts, it's not as evolved, and the athletes aren't to where the men are, just because they haven't had as much time. There are still some amazing fighters, it's just they haven't had the time to be able to develop it as much as the males. But because of where the males are right now, the females are evolving quicker than what, like, the male fighters had growing up in the sport. So either way, let's go back to the example. So you have a, like, striker versus grappler kind of thing. So the striker is going to, it's one of those things, like, you might land a couple leg kicks and everything like that, a couple punches, but if it's one of those things where the guy is able to time your kicks and take you down at will, you start thinking differently. It might be like a rhythm to you, like a reflex, to just throw a couple punches, throw a kick, throw a couple punches, throw a kick. Now, that guy is, like, the grappler is going to know, okay, well, you're throwing 1-2, and then you're throwing a kick. Okay, well, I'll block it, or, like, move from the 1-2, and then I'll catch the kick if I can, or I'll time my takedown like that. Like, they start figuring out different things. It's like you're basically, like, figuring out a puzzle in front of you, deconstructing some of it, and building it back up, like, as you're going along in this fight. I don't know, like, mixed martial arts is one of my most favorite things in the world, honestly. It's, I don't know, I could go on forever about it. There's just so many things, really, that, like, it can help you, like, with the way you look at things. It can help you, just, like, honestly, entertainment-wise, obviously. There's a lot of different things. Like, there's stories of certain fighters that are, like, super, super inspiring as well. So honestly, mixed martial arts, I'm just gonna close on it. I love it. I've loved it since basically the beginning, and I'm always gonna love it. Like, it's always gonna have a place in my heart for sure. So yeah. This has been Life Lessons with Juvy. I've been your host, Juvy the Kid, and I don't know why I pointed over my shoulder like that. Hit me up on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Periscope at Juvy the Kid, JuvyThaKid. All my quiet kids, freaks, and weirdos who love everybody. Keep being weird.